man perched up here. It was very extravagant of you.
It was a famous victory.
Do you feel guilty at all? I do.
Guilty?
You ought to more than me, really. You neglected your work this afternoon.
I worked this morning. A little relaxation never did harm to anyone. Why should either of us feel guilty?
I don't know.
How awfully nice you are. It is.
We walked back to the station together. Just as we reached the gates, he put his hand under my arm. I didn't notice it then, but I remember it now.
What's she like, your wife?
Madeline? Small, dark, rather delicate.
How funny. I should have thought you would have been fair.
And your husband, what's he like?
Medium height, brown hair, kindly, unemotional, and not delicate at all.
You said that proudly.
Did I?
Evening.
We've just got time for a cup of tea before our trains go.
And for the third time in 1 week, he brought that common man and his wife to the house without so much as a by your leave.
Two teas, please.
Cake or pastry?
Cake or pastry?
No, thank you.
Are those bath buns fresh?
Certainly they are, made this morning.
Two, please.
That'll be sevenpence. Take the tea to the table, Burial.
I'll carry the buns. Must eat one of these, fresh this morning.
Very fattening.
I don't hold with such foolishness.
They do look good, I must say.
One of my earliest passions in life. I've never outgrown it.
What happened then, Mrs. Beckett? Well, it's all very fine, I said, expecting me to do this, that, and the other, but what do I get out of it? You can't expect me to be a cook, housekeeper, and child rolled into one during the day, and a loving wife in the evening just because you feel like it. Oh, dear me, no. There are just as good fish in the sea, I said, as ever came out of it. And I packed my boxes then and there and left him.
Didn't you never go back?
Never. Went to my sister's place at Folkestone for a bit. Then I went in with a friend of mine and we opened a tea shop in Hythe.
What happened to him?
Dead as a doornail inside 3 years.
Well, I never.
Is tea bad for one? Worse than coffee, I mean.
If this was a professional interview, my fee's a guinea.
Why did you become a doctor?
Well, that's a long story. Perhaps because I'm a bit of an idealist.
I think all doctors ought to have ideals, really. Otherwise, their work would be unbearable.
Surely you're not encouraging me to talk shop.
Why shouldn't you talk shop? It's what interests you most, isn't it?
Yes, it is. I'm terribly ambitious, really. Not ambitious for myself so much as for my special pigeon.
What is your special pigeon?
Preventive medicine.
I see.
I'm afraid you don't.
I was trying to be intelligent.
Most good doctors, especially when they're young, have private dreams. That's the best part of them. Sometimes, though, those get over-professionalized and strangulated. Am I boring you?
No. I don't quite understand, but you're not boring me.
What I mean is this. All good doctors must, primarily, be enthusiasts. They must, like writers and painters and priests, they must have a sense of vocation. A deep-rooted, unsentimental desire to do good.
Yes, I see that.
Well, obviously, one way of preventing disease is worth 50 ways of curing it. That's where my ideal comes in. Preventive medicine isn't anything to do with medicine at all, really. It's concerned with conditions. Living conditions and hygiene and common sense. For instance, my specialty is pneumoconiosis.
Oh, dear.
Don't be alarmed. It's simpler than it sounds. It's nothing but a slow process of fibrosis of the lung due to the inhalation of particles of dust. In the hospital here, there are splendid opportunities for observing cures and making notes because of the coal mines.
You suddenly look much younger.
Do I?
Almost like a little boy.
What made you say that?
I don't know. Yes, I do.
Tell me.
No, I couldn't really. You were saying about the coal mines.
Oh, yes. The inhalation of coal dust. That's one specific form of the diseases. It's called anthracosis.
What are the others?
Chalicosis. That comes from metal dust. Steelworks, you know.
Yes, of course, steelworks.
And silicosis. That's stone dust. Gold mines.
I see. There's your train.
Yes.
You mustn't miss it.
No.
What's the matter?
Nothing. Nothing at all, really.
It's been so very nice. I've enjoyed my afternoon enormously.
I'm so glad. So have I. I apologize for boring you with long medical words.
I feel dull and stupid not to be able to understand more.
Shall I see you again?
It's the other platform, isn't it? We have to run. Don't bother about me. It might not do for a few minutes.
Can I see you again?
Yes, of course. Perhaps you'll come out to catch with one Sunday. It's rather far, I know, but we should be delighted.
Please. Please.
What is it?
Next Thursday, the same time.
No, I couldn't possibly.
Please. I ask you, most humbly.
You'll miss your train.
All right.
Run.
Goodbye.
I'll be there.
Thank you, my dear.
I stood there and watched his train draw out of the station. I stared after it until its tail light had vanished into the darkness. I imagined him getting out at Churney, giving up his ticket, walking back through the streets, letting himself into his house with his latch key. His wife, Madeline, would probably be in the hall to meet him. Or perhaps upstairs in her room, not feeling very well. Small, dark, and rather delicate. I wondered if he'd say, I met such a nice woman at the Cardoma. We had lunch and went to the pictures. And then suddenly I knew that he wouldn't. I knew beyond a shadow of doubt that he wouldn't say a word. And at that moment, the first awful feeling of danger swept over me. I got into the first compartment I saw. I wanted to get home as quickly as possible. I looked hurriedly around the carriage to see if anyone was looking at me, as if they could read my secret thoughts. No one was, except a clergyman in the opposite corner. I felt myself blushing and opened my library book and pretended to read. By the time I'd got to Ketchworth, I'd made up my mind definitely that I wasn't going to see Alec anymore.
Good evening, Mrs. Jesson.
It was silly and undignified flirting like that with a complete stranger.
Good evening.
I walked up to the house quite briskly and cheerfully. I'd been behaving like an idiot, admittedly, but after all, no harm had been done. You met me in the hall. Your face was strained and worried, and my heart sank.
Fred, what's the matter?
It's all right, old girl, but you must keep calm and not be upset.
Well, what is it? What's wrong?
It's Bobby. He was knocked down by a car on the way home from school. Oh. Now, it's not serious. He was just grazed by the mudguard, but it knocked him against the curb, and he's got slight concussion. The doctor's upstairs with him now.
It's all right, Mrs. Jesson. Nothing to worry about. He'll be as right as rain in a few hours.
You're sure? You're sure it's not serious?
Quite sure. But it was certainly a very lucky escape. I've given him a little sedative, and I shall advise keeping him at home for a couple of days. It must have been a bit of a shock, and his right arm...
I felt so dreadful, Fred, looking at him lying there with that bandage around his head. I tried not to show it, but I was quite hysterical inside. As though the whole thing were my fault. A sort of punishment. An awful, sinister warning.